Well, good morning. Welcome to Sharon Baptist Church. We're so glad that you're here with us on this bright, sunny, warm day outside. It's nice in here, isn't it? And we're glad to be here, and we're glad that you're here. If you're our guest, we are so thankful that you're here. Hope you picked up a bulletin on your way inside. Inside of that, not only is there great information about the life of the church, but there's also a tear-out tab. And I encourage everyone just to take a moment and to tear that out of your bulletin, because that is a great resource for everybody. Guest, of course, there is a place for you to put down some information. We'd love to get to know you. That's a great way for that to happen. You can either fill that out and put it in our offering plate, or you can hand it to us before you leave today. But we would love to get you to get to know you more. So please fill that out and get that to us. On the other side, there's a place for prayer requests and prayer concerns. You can mark that if you want that to be private or something that's added to one of our prayer lists. Again, just get that to us before you leave today, and we will pray along with you. We'll get that added to the list if you'd like, and we will join you in prayer. Well, it's a great day to be in the house of the Lord. We have so many great elements to our service today, and I'm excited to worship together with you. Let's have a word of prayer as we begin our time together. Father, we come into your house this morning with hearts that are ready and expectant to worship you. And Father, I pray that as we come and we worship through song and worship through the study of your word, I pray that you would challenge us, that you would convict us, Father, that you would draw us close to yourself. We love you, we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, and welcome once again to Sharon Baptist Church. What a glorious day is that we can gather to serve the risen Savior. And at this time, I invite you to stand and join with us in singing to that Savior as we sing Glorious Day, a song we introduced last week. Amen. Do we feel the presence of the Holy Spirit with us this morning?
Amen.
Holy Spirit, you are indeed welcome here. Please remain standing for our scripture and prayer.
Good morning, my church family. Listening to that song, I remember that 24 hours ago, I was in Woodstock, Georgia, at the men's conference. And in that auditorium were 6,000 men standing and singing praise songs to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Absolutely. And it was a powerful, powerful moment to hear those voices united in singing from the heart to our Father. And this morning, I am glad to be at Sharon Baptist Church because that Holy Spirit is here today, too, and to worship with my church family in this intimate setting is beyond words. What a blessing we receive together this day. Amen. Thank you, Father. Our scripture today, I get to read to you from the book of Acts, the 16th chapter, verses 9 and 10. And it goes, during the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. Let's pray together. Oh, Heavenly Father, what blessings we have already received today, Father. I just can't list them all. Just beginning with the warm, dry house that I woke up to this morning, surrounded by my wife, and to come to your house of worship, Father, and to see my church family. And we sat and we spoke and we studied your word together this morning, Heavenly Father. We studied your promises, we studied your assurances, and we apply those things to our life. What a blessing, Father. And I know the blessing will continue, Father, and we ask your blessings on this worship service that we are participating in. Father, look at us. Search our hearts. Find us. Find us acceptable. We pray for our Pastor Mark as he speaks your words to us today. Prepare our hearts. Prepare our minds to receive your word, Father. And I ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. It's in his name I pray. Amen.
You love it. I'm longing.
are truly blessed to be here this morning. Give thanks to God for all those blessings. We'll sing hymn 668, the doxology. This morning to give God glory. So let's sing hymn number 28, To God Be the Glory. We'll sing all three verses. More precious than silver. We'll sing this chorus two times.
Oh,
314, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
If our children will come forward, we'll have our time together. Good morning. Good to see all of you all this morning. And we've been talking a lot the last few weeks about following Jesus, about how he leads us through life if we will look to him and if we'll trust in him. And I've used this example before, but one of the ways we can think of how Jesus leads in our life is by thinking about a flashlight. Now, if you shine a flashlight in somebody's eyes, what happens?
You get blinded.
Yeah, they can't see. And also you get your flashlight taken away, don't you? That's right. But a flashlight, if we use it like we're supposed to, can really help us. You know, in the daylight, see, if you shine that on the floor, you can barely see it, can't you? But if we get it a little bit darker, I think we're going to get it a little bit darker. The darker it is, the more that light shines and shows up, doesn't it? But if I go outside at night and I shine a flashlight, oh, now it's down. See, it keeps getting a little brighter. Okay. If I go out at night and I shine a flashlight, it won't shine a mile, will it? No. I can't see as far as I would see in the daytime, but I can see far enough to walk a few steps. And as I walk a few steps, if we look at the spot on the floor there, if as I walk forward, the light keeps going forward too, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So that it's always lighting at least our next step. As we face our life, you know, I don't know what's going to happen in 10 years or 20 years. I don't even know what's going to happen in 1 year.
In 10 years, I might be 18 or something.
That's right. But if I'm trusting Jesus and following him, he may not show me what's 10 years away, but he'll show me what I need to do today. If I follow him each day, then I will make it to where God wants me to be. Let's have a word of prayer together. Father, I thank you that you shine your light in our lives, and that through that light you show us your way. You show us how we are to live, and you help us in the decisions that we have to make. I pray your guidance for each of these children, but also for all of us as we seek your direction. Help us to see where you would have us to go, to see those you would have us to speak with and share your word with, and to see what you would have us to do as we seek to serve you. Thank you for your grace in our lives, in Jesus' name. Now, Lloyd has some of these.
I have a question.
Yes.
Sometimes when it's nighttime, my daddy uses his flashlight, and he can see where he's going.
Cool. Well, we have a flashlight for each one of you, and Lloyd's going to give it to you at the end of Children's Church, okay? And if you don't go to Children's Church, you can see me after church, and I'll have some for you.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, choir. Answering the call of God in our lives is something each of us must do. No decision in life is more critical in determining who we will become, what we will accomplish, where we will go. Understanding that God has a plan, a vision for each of our lives is empowering. Knowing that God is able to work in spite of and even through our mistakes, our misfortunes, and that He can still accomplish great things for His kingdom if we are willing to trust Him and turn to His ways. Knowing that is awe-inspiring. Last week we looked at Paul's call experience on the road to Damascus and at God's vision for his life. How that vision gave Paul strength and resolve for the different trials that he faced in his life. When he was discouraged, and let us not forget that Paul did get discouraged. He tells the church at Corinth, "For we do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, of our trouble which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened beyond measure, above strength, so that we despaired even of life." That's discouraged. But even when things were tough, his certainty of God's vision for his life gave him strength to continue. God's call was foundational. God's vision was empowering. But as important as these two things are, they're not enough. We still need God's guidance. Call and vision answer the question, what am I going to do with my life? But guidance answers the question, what am I going to do today? Call and vision our big picture. The guidance is dealing with the details of our lives. We see in the verses Greg read for us an example of that daily quest in Paul's life. You know, I think sometimes we look at Paul's life and we see that dramatic call experience. We read his words in 2 Corinthians, and he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness." And we get this image that Paul walked so closely with the Lord that he just heard God speak audibly each day. And he always knew exactly what God wanted him to do. Well, the passage from Acts chapter 16 shows us a little more of what it must have been like as Paul sought daily to follow God's direction. I want to go back to that chapter, if you will, and back a little further than Greg started, back to verse 6 of Acts 16. And we'll read through there and see how God directed Paul in his life. Beginning with verse 6, now, when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. After they had come to Mysia, they tried to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. So passing by Mysia, they came to Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul. These are the verses Greg read. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man from Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. Now after he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel to them. Therefore, sailing from Troas, we ran a straight course to Samothrace, and the next day came to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is the foremost city of that part of Macedonia, a colony. And we were staying in that city for some days. Wouldn't it be simpler if it said, now, when they had gone through Phrygia and Galatia, a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man from Macedonia stood and pleaded with them. Wouldn't that have simplified things a whole lot? If Paul knew from the moment he finished whatever he was doing in Galatia that the next place for him to go would be into Macedonia, to Philippi, where we know that he had a very significant ministry. Instead, though, we find a process. As Paul is searching for God's direction, reasoning where it seemed we would go next, through Phrygia and Galatia and into Asia. Oh, no? Okay, well, we'll veer north into Bithynia. No? Perhaps we need to head toward the coast to Troas. Ah, now we are on the right track. Paul's search for God's direction in his life was much more like ours than we might tend to think. You see, if I convince myself that it was somehow easier for Paul, then I can excuse myself because I just don't put forth the effort. When I just go my way instead of searching for God's way. But he spoke to Paul. I've never heard his voice. If he would just speak to me and tell me where to go, well, I'd go. The reality is, the journey with God is always a daily one. It was a daily journey for Abraham as he set out to follow God. Where? Simply to a place that I will show you. It was a daily one for Peter and the other disciples when they answered the call to follow me. And it was a daily journey for Paul as he adjusted his course each time he hit a wall. And it is a daily journey for us. The important thing to see in Paul's struggle to find God's direction is what he is doing as he is seeking. It doesn't say, well, the Holy Spirit would not let him go into Asia, so Paul just sat there in Galatia until God gave him a vision of what was next. Even as Paul was struggling to know exactly where God was leading him at that time, He knew what God had called him to do. He knew God's vision for his life. He is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. He was called to bear his name, the name of Christ, to the nations. So he continued to do what he knew to do, even while he awaited direction in what he didn't know. Now, this was not the only time that Paul struggled for God's direction. He writes to the Romans, Now, I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I often planned to come to you, but was hindered until now, that I might have some fruit among you just as among the other Gentiles. Time and again, Paul had began his journey toward Rome to find out, not yet. See, he knew that he would bear God's word to Rome. He just didn't know when. And he waited for God's timing. Now, I doubt that Paul ever imagined that when that day came, he would go to Rome as a prisoner. And if he had known that he would go to Rome as a prisoner, he would have felt like there would be little he could do. Yet what we find is that he did indeed go as a prisoner, and yet was able to share in a very significant way the gospel of Jesus Christ with those who were there. We see another struggle for God's direction as Paul and Barnabas are preparing to go on this journey that we just read about. In chapter 15, Acts says, "But Paul insisted that they should not take with them the one who had departed from them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them in the word. Then the contention became so sharp that they parted from one another. And so Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and departed, being commended by the brethren to the grace of God." Both Paul and Barnabas knew that they needed to go on another journey to share the gospel, that they needed to go back to some of the churches they had already started and give them strength and encouragement in their journey. They both knew God's vision for them. They just couldn't agree, not on where to go, but on who to take with them. Barnabas says, "I think we need to give Mark a second chance." Paul said, "Nope. He let us down the first time. Not counting on him again." And the dispute became so sharp among them that they decided the best thing to do was go their separate ways. Barnabas took Mark, mentored him, shepherded him, and helped him to grow into a leader that Paul would later say was very useful in the kingdom. And Paul took Silas and began the missionary journey that we read about in Acts and reached many people with the gospel of Christ. God used both of them as they followed him in their separate journeys. The best way for us to discern what we need to do, the best way for us to discern what we do not know about what God wants us to do is to do what we already know God wants us to do. We know that God wants us to spend time with Him regularly in prayer and the study of His Word. We know that God wants us to be in fellowship with His people, that we are to gather regularly for corporate worship. Now, we hear all the time, well, I can worship God on the lake or in a tree stand just the same as I can in church. You can worship there. We hear people say, well, I can be a Christian without going to church. You can. But you cannot be the Christian God is calling you to be if you are not in fellowship with God's people. And you cannot have the worship experience of the community of God when you worship Him all alone. That personal time of worship is precious, but it's no substitute for gathering with God's people. Lifting Him up in praise. We know that God wants us to be witnesses for Him. I don't tighten up. I don't mean necessarily sharing the plan of salvation or quoting Scripture, though those things are wonderful, and I encourage you to grow in those areas. But we're called to be witnesses. First of all, simply by sharing with those we come into contact with what God has done in our lives. We know that God wants us to live a life that honors Him. How we live, how we speak, how we treat others. If we are not doing the things that we know we are to do, and how can we be surprised when God does not reveal to us other things that He would have us to do? Imagine you come to me and tell me you're lost. I don't mean in the spiritual sense. I just mean you can't find a certain location you're trying to get to. And you come and say, Mark, I just cannot find this place. I've been searching and searching and I can't find it. And I see you've got a map. You got a GPS in your car and you got one on your phone. And I say, well, which one are you using? Oh, well, none of them. I've got a map, but it's so hard to fold back up if I open it up. And if I use the GPS on my phone, it runs the battery down and then I might not be able to talk to somebody later. I get annoyed with that voice on the one in the car. So I've just been driving around aimlessly, hoping that I'll stumble across the place I'm trying to find. Obviously, that's a ridiculous example. But how can we hope to find that place we're trying to find if we're not using the tools that we already have to help us find our way? People are so frustrated today. Well, just don't sense God's direction in my life. I want to ask, well, what are you doing now? When Paul was hindered from going into Asia, he didn't just stop, throw up his hands. He simply adjusted his course. He continued to share the gospel wherever he went because he knew that was God's call on his life. When God stopped him from going into Bithynia, he just adjusted his course again. And gradually, as he bumped into walls and adjusted his course, God got him to the place where he needed to be. But everywhere he went, he did what he already knew he was supposed to do. Do you want to know God's will for your life? we use that term like it's such a mysterious thing. I'm searching for God's will. Well, I just don't know God's will. Well, what is God's will for me? You want to know what God's will is for you? Begin by serving Him today. We know that's His will. Serve Him right where you are, doing just what you are doing. And if something needs to change, He'll let you know. Maybe not in a dramatic way, but He will let you know. I graduated from high school. What am I going to do? Well, I guess I'll go to college. Where am I going to go? I had a guidance counselor who helped me get a scholarship to UT. Okay, I'll go to UT. Prayed a very dangerous prayer. I said, Lord, if this is not where you want me, let me know. Didn't see any blinding lights. Didn't hear any voices from heaven. But I knew almost from day one when I stepped on the campus at UT that that was not where God wanted me. Now, I didn't just pack up and go home and sit and wait till God showed me where He did want me. I was enrolled in school. I went to class occasionally. I finished my first year of college, and I continued to seek God's direction. And I began to believe that Carson Newman was where I needed to go. People say, you're going to be a minister? I don't know. I just think I need to go to Carson Newman. And so I began to go to Carson Newman. For about half of my tenure there, I had an undeclared major. Colin's here. I shouldn't be saying this where he can hear it. I had an undeclared major because I didn't know what I was going to do. But I continued to take the courses that interested me and that seemed to be moving me forward. And I met with an advisor, and he said, well, looking at what you're taking, looks like you're going to need to major in religion. Okay. If you want to graduate, you're going to have to major in religion. So I majored in religion. Well, then you graduate with a bachelor's degree in religion. What do you do with that? I guess I'll go to seminary. Still don't know what I'm going to do with my life. Thought maybe I'd be a chaplain. I knew by this time it was going to be some professional form of ministry. But I went off to seminary still not seeing myself as a pastor. But in the course of my time there, not only through my courses in seminary, but through my work in the church and through the leadership of a mentor that God put into my life, I began to sense His call into the pastoral ministry. Now, when I was 18 years old at University of Tennessee and God said, you're going the wrong way, I want you to be a pastor, I'd have been like Jonah on that boat to anywhere but where He sent me. But as I followed one step along the way, He got me to the place where He was calling me to be. Doesn't have to be a flash of light. Doesn't have to be an audible voice. If you will follow God each day, He will help you to get where He is calling you to be. I have a PS on God's vision for your life. We talked about that last week. And I said and still firmly believe that God has a vision for each life. He's got a plan for you, each of you. But there's something I want to say, and that is that I believe there are many people who fulfill God's vision for their lives and never even realize it. They never really have that sense that this is what I'm called to do. But they live out day by day what God is leading them to do today. Jesus said, when the Son of Man comes in His glory, He says, He's going to say to those on His right hand, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me." And the righteous looked at him and said, "What? When did we do all that?" Do anything significant? Well, you know, when I had a chance to help somebody along the way, I tried to do that. When I sensed that there was a need that I could respond to, I tried to respond. I never really did anything significant. And the Lord said, "Inasmuch as you did it unto one of these, the least of my brethren, did it to me." Many faithful folks live their lives never realizing how God is working through them, yet serving each day the best they know how. When those people stand before their Lord, I'm afraid they'll be ashamed that they've not done any great work for the Lord. The Lord will look at them and say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." Follow Jesus today. Didn't bring my flashlight, but just walk to the edge of the light. You take one more step. And see that He will light that step and the next step and the next. He will lead you today where He wants you to be today and to what He wants you to accomplish today. And as you continue to walk with Him day by day, He will accomplish in and through you more than you ever imagined. Answering God's call is where it all begins. Receiving God's vision for you will give you strength, resolve. But following God's call, one day at a time, is how God changes your life and how He touches lives all around you. Will you pray with me? Father, as we come this morning, I'm thankful that there are people gathered here who have a strong sense of Your vision, Your plan for their life. And I pray that You will help them to understand that to reach that goal, your goal for their lives. They must follow you each day. And Lord, I know there are others gathered this morning who have sought for an understanding of your plan for their lives, but have struggled. They can't seem to see that big picture. Help them this morning to understand that the way to reach that destination you would have for them is by following each day. Even if they can't see the end of the journey, help them to take the steps that you light for them. And step by step to find your will for their lives. Lord, thank you for your faithfulness to lead us as we will follow. Give us the courage and the faith to follow as you lead. May your will be done in each life, today and throughout our lives. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we come this morning to our time of response, each one of us has an opportunity this morning to respond to the leadership of God's Holy Spirit. Excuse me. Again, you may have that long-term vision. You may understand God's plan for your life. Or you may be struggling. But either way, it begins by doing what God is calling you to do today. Do what you know He's called you to do. And He'll gradually reveal what you might not even imagine today. It's a journey of faith. It begins with that first step of trusting Him. Trusting Him with your life and your salvation, but also trusting Him with today and what today will bring. We have people in all different stages of your journey this morning. Each of us has the opportunity to respond to God. If He's moving in your life, I pray that He'll lead you, that you'll respond as He leads you. Whether that's right where you stand or you need to come forward, or something you would share with me or one of the other pastors. Whether it's to take that first step of trusting in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or whether you need to take some other step of faith. As God moves in your life this morning, you respond as He leads and as we sing together.
Our invitation for this morning is hymn 437, "Wherever He Leads, I'll Go." Let's stand and sing together.
Have a seat for a moment. Thank you for being with us today. We appreciate your coming as we share and worship together. It's game day. Some people are saying, all right, and some people are saying, huh? What do you mean? There is a game this afternoon that some people are excited about. But it's also a game this afternoon that some people are refusing to watch. We understand that. So we're going to have game day. If you want to watch the game, it'll be in the back part of the youth area. There's several TV screens in there, and you can watch the game and cheer and have a ball. But if you don't want to watch that game, we're going to have other games out in the front part of the youth area. We'll have board games. You can bring dominoes, whatever you like to play. Because the big thing is we just want to have fellowship together. So you come tonight. Bad news is, Harry's grandbaby had surgery this week, so Harry's not fixing wings. But we found another source, so we're going to have some good wings. And we're going to count on you all to bring food with you. Just bring something for you to munch on and to share with others. And we'll have a great time of fellowship, whether you want to watch that other game or not. But we hope you'll be with us, because it's a great time to share together. We enjoy this time. And hope this is a good way that we can all share together. Rick's got a ton of other announcements, so I'm going to shut up so he can bring those and share our prayer concerns this morning.
All right. Don't forget, if you're interested in going to the New York mission trip this summer, please make sure you contact the church office by tomorrow. You can see Mark or Greg Jones for that. This past Wednesday, we had some new men's and women's Bible studies that began. It's still not too late. They're meeting on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. Today is at 4 o'clock is deacon's meeting. This coming Saturday is upper games. We had a Saturday off yesterday, but we're going to have more games this coming Saturday. And Teen Challenge will be there. So they'll be doing our halftime devotion. So if you're interested in coming and supporting them, they'll have a table with some of their handmade items and that sort of thing. And come and support them, hear their testimonies as they share with our halftime devotions. And then don't forget, as Mark mentioned, the game day today. This evening, a great time to get together after our January Bible study, our evening worship service for that. And then also coming up, if you are a first-time guest, we are glad that you are here. And if we haven't given you a gift yet, we would love to do that. One of our pastors will be right outside here. Outside the door in the hallway there. Please stop by so we can get to see you and meet you and have a gift for you. And as we get to our prayer concerns this week, there are a lot of different things coming up with people having surgery. We've got quite a few having surgery this week. Joe Pratt will be having surgery on Monday. Brian McCoy also on Monday. On Tuesday, Denise Thompson will be having surgery. And on Thursday, Joe Atkins and Kyla Witt will be having surgery on Thursday. And then this past week, Ronnie Wells had surgery on Friday. And then, as Mark mentioned about Griffin, Hamby had surgery on this past Friday as well. Lots of people that are sick and going on. And just keep each other in your prayers. Keep these people in your prayers, especially upcoming this week for for their surgeries that's upcoming. I think that's all the announcements and prayer concerns that I have. Maybe all of them. Or maybe some more.
All the announcements.
All the announcements. Is that it? What? What? The what? The soup? Good job. I appreciate that. Now, all right. We got it. All right, so coming up.
The goalpost.
Okay, goalpost. Daniel, there we go. Come on in here. All right. Thank you. Okay, so here we go. We got our goalpost. All right. Turn it around just a little bit more so everybody can see. All right. Thank you. All right. Point out, what's up at the upper left hand? What's up there? 2017 total. Now, what's on the other side? What's that number? The money, $5,101.78. You've probably seen these around all over the place. And so that is how much we raised last year. Okay? So we are wanting to be what number?
5,101.78.
That's what we want to be this year. Okay? And our money that we are bringing in is going toward Western Heights and Montgomery Village to their Baptist centers. Last year, we were able to give them lots of soup and vegetables and lots of stuff they were able to utilize for their ministries. But we're doing a competition, too, okay? And you're going to be seeing some videos from them and see what all they used that money last year. But a competition in your bulletin, there is information on the teams from our Sunday school departments, okay? So you'll be competing against your totals from last year again. And each week, as we move up to that total, what's that total, Eli? There you go. You've got it memorized, and I don't. That's good. All right. Now, that's the total we're going to be. And as we move up each week, you'll see a total, and then we'll reveal a message that's behind here each week until we get to the first Sunday in March where we will see who the winner is. Okay? Now, here's the key. We're doing it competition for departments of Sunday school, right? So if you want to give, the best way to give is through what? Prayer. And on Sundays, at what time would you say would be a good time to give? Any time, but especially 9:30 on Sunday mornings, right? Because what happens at 9:30 on Sunday morning? Sunday school. 9:30. Sunday school, okay? So come be a part. If you're unable to be here for Sunday school or not a part, you can give money, mark it on there. You can put it to whichever department you want to give, especially if you want to give it to which department? The children. Children and youth, right? Because that's your part of, right? So you'll take any kind of money, right? All right. So if you're not a part of a Sunday school class, we would love for you to come be a part of that, not only just to participate in raising money for our great ministries at Montgomery Village and Western Heights, but also to grow in your walk with Christ, to be able to do this together with fellow believers. And we're looking forward to see what God's going to do through you guys. And it's an honor to be able to do this with you all, to see that we can impact not just people's physical needs, but also their spiritual needs as well. All right, Eli? Break. Good job. Thank you. Father God, Lord, we come to you today, first of all, praising you for what a wonderful and mighty God that you are and for bringing us together, even though it is just very cold and dreary day outside, but you have given us a place that we can come and worship you in dry and in warmth, and we thank you and praise you for that, Lord. Lord, I pray that you will be with all these many different prayer concerns that were mentioned. Lord, that you will let them know that you are there and you are in control. Give them comfort, give them guidance, give them peace. And God, I pray that you will be with each one of us, that we will pray and see what you want us to give in order to go to these ministries that affect so many different people, that we be able to just give of some money to go toward that to help them, but also that we will pray for Montgomery Village and Western Heights and the Baptist centers there with Tom and Shannon as they lead those ministries, that you will use them to continue to impact the community that they are in for you and for the gospel. And God, I pray that you will help us to, as we go to wherever you may place us, may take us, that we will take your gospel with us in your love, in your grace. God, once again, thank you for bringing us together. Help us as we go today, wherever we may go. We will give you all the honor, glory, and praise. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We'll close this morning with the chorus of hymn 557, More Precious Than Silver. Will you stand with us singing our benediction this morning?